إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وبعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. There's some room there for you guys. جزاك الله خير. السلام عليكم أفادي ومختار. Join us يا أخي. It's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anytime we gather together to mention His words. And initially, it's important for us to acknowledge that no one speaks about Allah better than himself. And no one honors Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in speech, in description, than himself. And no one narrates to us about Allah better than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore, any discussion that we may contribute towards seeking an explanation or a meaning to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fail at doing justice. And therefore, the constant theme amongst the people who study and teach the Qur'an is that the Qur'an is a book and a revelation, a scripture that is received from above. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always says, tanzila. It's something that I brought down in stages. Its weight is too much to be delivered in one go. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined the best of hearts to be the one to receive a Qur'an that if it was to be received by a mountain, it would crumble. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hashr, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ. If this Qur'an, this thing you recite, this ever-pertinent reminder that I have sent as the final message to humanity, if it was to be delivered to a mountain, it would seize and crumble and shake by the might of the word that has been received. And therefore, before we begin talking about Surah Al-Mulk, it's really important, I think, to set how it is that the people of Islam have come to approach the Qur'an. And the Qur'an has always been something that is categorized. Now, one of the things I think is a part of the usul of the study of our deen, is that you can categorize things any way you like. So you can, you know, use different names. This section is for this purpose, this section is for that purpose. Categorization or nomenclature is a human interaction with the Qur'an. And the scholars, they actually, when they analyze the Qur'an, they would break it down into different sections, and they would say, you know, these surahs are grouped together for this purpose, and these verses are grouped together for this purpose. وَالْعِلْمُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. But the knowledge ultimately is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's begin from the very initial purpose of the Qur'an. There are two main branches of what the Qur'an seeks to do. Two main sections. The first of it are things that we call the roots, the usul. The things that relate to what we believe, why we believe it, who we believe in. And then there's a second section which branches off from those roots. It grows from that stable trunk. And you see this allusion in the Qur'an and the statements of the Prophet ﷺ often. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَثَلُ كَلِمَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٍ. When you look at that kalima, this La ilaha illallah, give it the imagery of a tree that its roots are deep into the ground. So there's books written about the trees of faith, the tree of faith, and the branches that emerge from that tree. And therefore you hear in the authentic hadith of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, and there's a book written by Al-Imam Al-Bayhaqi carrying the same name, Shu'ab Al-Iman, the branches or the subsidiaries of faith. where the Prophet ﷺ said that this faith that has been delivered to you, بِضْعٌ وَسِتُونَ أَوْ بِضْعٌ وَسَبْعُونَ شُعْبًا, it has 60 or 70 different branches of it. The least of it, that you see something harmful in the path of people, so you remove it. That's from Iman. It's a sign of faithfulness that you recognize there's one above you in authority, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if you see something that you feel could harm someone, your heart moves you, I need to correct this. وَالْحَيَاءُ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. And having modesty, haya, in any aspect of your life is a firm part of faith. It is a touch in every aspect of faith. And therefore, when you hear this word haya, it sounds like haya. It sounds like life, right? Because haya is used in every part of your life. Haya in what you wear, haya in what you eat it, how much you spend on it. Haya in what you say, how you say it, who you say it to. Haya is in everything. You need to have that sense of bashfulness, modesty, withholding yourself back between you and society because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, because there are these two branches, there are these two sections, the roots had to be laid down first. And therefore the Imams of Islam, they began talking about the Meccan surahs. The majority of the Quran, in terms of the number of surahs, were revealed in Mecca al-Mukarramah. And the Meccan surahs have a totally different flavor, totally different sound, totally different rhythm to the surahs that are revealed in Al-Madinah. And if you were to hear, if you come to know of it, if you begin to listen to the surahs revealed in Mecca, you see that the verses are short. Ar-Rahman. One word. Allam al-Qur'an. And notice how Allah joins His mercifulness with the Qur'an. And it's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Ar-Rahman, this Lord of mercy, His expression of His mercy can be found in Al-Qur'an, which He seeks you to learn it. And notice how the Qur'an is always linked with knowledge, because no greater knowledge is than the knowledge of the Qur'an. Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Qur'an, Khalaqa al-Insan. Then comes the creation of man, which means to you in that syntax that the Lord of mercy intended the Qur'an to be the method of knowledge and teaching for the humanity that He had not yet created, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore the message of the Qur'an was coherent even before the creation of Adam. What Allah wanted as being haq was always haq, even before Adam came into existence, alayhi salam. So there were roots, and they were laid in Mecca. The rhythm of the Quran, even its sound, you know, those short verses were for a purpose. The people in Mecca wouldn't give the Prophet ﷺ a chance. Every time he'd say one or two verses, they would cut him off, they would walk away, they'd put cotton in their ears. They used to stop the people entering into Mecca during the time of Hajj, and they would tell them, put cotton in your ear, فَإِنَّ كَلَامَهُ كَالسِّحْرِ, because the words you're going to hear from this guy, they are bewitching, they're magical in their sound and their rhythm and their meaning. And you know, some of those who came to Islam, they said, I put Qur'an in my ears. He said, I put it in my ears, فَأَبَى اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَن يُسْمِعَنِ الْقُرْآنِ, but Allah forbade that I leave Mecca except the Qur'an penetrated through the cotton. So I took the cotton out of my ears and I spoke to myself, إِنَّكَ رَجُلٌ شَاعِرٌ لَبِيبٌ, you're a man who's a poet. You're a man who's intelligent. You have an intellect. تَعْرِفُ الْقَبِيحَ مِنَ الْحَسَنِ, you know how to differentiate good from bad. Listen to what the man has to say. Who should tell you not to at least listen? Listen to what he has to say. See, it's in that context that this surah was revealed. It's in that moment in these Meccan surahs that Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, when there was that antagonism and they would deter people from him, peace and blessings be upon him. And of course the man, he says, as soon as I heard the Quran and I listened to it with an open heart, and let my ears access it, and I came at it with sincerity, I came to faith. So roots were laid down in Mecca. The rhythm of the Quran was short verses so that people could hear one or two, but the short verses also had a rhythm that led you on to want to know what's coming next. almost like a cliffhanger effect. And you would hear Ar-Rahman. Okay, who is he? Allama al-Qur'an. He's the one who taught the Qur'an. Why? Khalaqa al-insan. So what does he want from al-insan? Allamahu al-bayan. He created him and wants him to learn. Gave him the ability to study and teach and knowledge. Ash-shams wal-qamar. Don't you think you're the center of everything? Look to the sun and the moon. Bihusban. All of them are accounted for. Wal-najm wal-shajar yasjudan. Don't you know that the stars and the trees prostrate to Allah? Was-sama. The heavens above you, all of it is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they would, even though they didn't want to listen and they would walk away, they'd walk away slowly because they want to keep hearing it. And there's verses, you know, subhanallah, in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would wake up in the morning and he would see the footprint of the mushrikeen outside his home. And they would sit under his window, outside his door, listening to him recite the Qur'an in his prayer. And in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, Abu Sufyan, who later becomes a Muslim, he describes those early days. He said, you know, one day I actually bumped into Abu Jahl. In the darkness of the night, we'd come when there wasn't any moon, so no one would see us. We'd cover ourselves up, and we'd sit there. And all of a sudden, I bump into him, he bumps into me. I say, hey, what are you doing here? He said, I'm doing what you're doing. Wallahi inna kalamahu lahu lahalawa. His words has a beauty to it. But we can't accept it. Because he's from this tribe, we're from this tribe, he's from this place, we're from... Al-mukabara, the arrogance would overcome them. So when the Prophet would come and see their footprints, and Allah would tell him who was listening to him last night, Allah says that the Prophet, لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ نَفْسُكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ. You are so excessively sorrowful, mournful, at them not coming to faith. And Allah says to the Prophet, don't have that sorrow. إِن لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَبَدًا. They will not come to faith. That Abu Jahl will not accept, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from you. So those are the Meccan surahs. Then there are the Medina surahs. The Medina surahs have a very distinct flavor. Their verses are longer, the longest surahs in the Qur'an you will find in Medina. The surahs are longer, not just the verses, but the surahs are longer. There are now, it's not just about what is faith, what is the Day of Judgment, who is Allah, what is right, what is wrong. Now it is about the legislation and the rulings and the regulations that you must live by to achieve that final place of happiness that you seek with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the ulama, they identify, it's not just the Meccan surahs and the Medina surahs, but they identify two prophets of Allah, messengers of Allah, who become very important and significant. The two most spoken of prophets of Allah that are given to us in our ummah as an example to follow are Ibrahim and Musa. And Ibrahim's example is usul. He talks about faith. The sun, la hadha rabbi, no, this isn't God. The qamar, the moon, this isn't Allah. The stars, they leave. That's not God. This idol, he breaks it. That's not God. You don't hear of any of this from Musa. Musa, the second prophet who's given to us, it's all about rules and regulations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave tashri'ah to Musa. And therefore you hear Allah introduces suhufi Ibrahim wa Musa. They become the two first prophets mentioned to our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first of them, Ibrahim, listen to him, ya Muhammad. وَمَنْ يَتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Follow, وَاتَّبِعُ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Follow the way of Ibrahim in that Hanafi way, that pure way, cleansed way, where he has disassociated from anything that is worshipped other than Allah. And then when it comes to Musa, أَلْقَى الْأَلْوَاحِ. Allah gave him the alwah. فِيهِ هُدًى وَنُورٍ. He received the Torah. In it was light and guidance for the people to learn how to live according to its teachings. Not just its teachings of Tawheed, but its teachings of what's right and wrong, what to eat, what not to eat. And therefore, when you and I, we look at our Sharia, when our sisters wear hijab, they're not surprised to know that there are laws of hijab for Jewish women, for our cousins in faith. You know, when I talk about hijab in my class, or we talk about haya in year 9 in my class, Islamic studies class, I actually begin by getting them to write an essay about what is haya in the faith other than our faith. And all of a sudden they're like, oh, I didn't know that they have to wear a scarf. that they have to wear, leggings, that they can't show this part of their skin, this part of their hair, that many practicing Jewish women, they actually wear a wig. That's their hijab. So you see her, you think it's her hair, but it's not her hair. It's actually a wig that they wear. And that's their form of hijab. That's how they camouflage their natural beauty. And some of the most interesting writings is reading some of the writings of the rabbis debating, is it right if she looks better with the wig than her normal hair? Right? Is it really haya in that sense? Right? So, it's very interesting to see that many of our laws, our dietary laws, you and I have no problem eating kosher food on an airplane. Why? Because it meets the very same strict standards that we have as Muslims when it comes to halal dietary acts of eating and permissibility. So therefore you see the Quran has those two things, the roots and the branches. And they are symbolized in Ibrahim and Musa, symbolized in the Meccan surahs and the Medina surahs. The ulama, they further classify the Quran into three sections. And they say that there is one third of the Quran, which they take from this hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which is an authentic hadith. He said that the one who recites Al-Ikhlas, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ Surah Al-Ikhlas, تَعْدِلُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ It is equivalent to a third of the Quran. What is meant by this hadith is that it contains the message of a third of the Quran. One third of the verses of the Quran, if not more, tell you about who is Allah. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْحَيُّ الْقَيُّومُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ Right? لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ قُلْ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ الرحمن الرحيم الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار verses that tell you about who is Allah, a third of the Quran. Another third of the Quran deals with al-ghayb, the things you would not know if not from Allah. They talk to you about the malaika, about the day of judgment, about al-jannah, about an-nar, about the prophets who came before us whose stories have been convoluted and corrupted. So all of a sudden you begin to hear the inner message of what Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, actually said, what he actually believed, in comparison to what has been corrupted by the hands of man and the tongues that have defamed him, alayhi salam. The third part of the Quran talks about our tashri'ah, the rules and regulations. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ وَيَسْأَلُكَ النَّاسِ They ask you, they ask you, they ask you, قُلْ Answer to them about the things that they need to know in their life. And therefore you have rules about what we eat, what we drink, what we wear, what we don't wear. All of them take root from the Quran. In the Quran, of course, there's also three messages. And, you know, the very elementary study of the Quran tells you that the Quran, it seeks to prove three things. Allahu ma'budun bihaq. The first is that Allah is the one you worship and it's the only reality, it's the only truth. That no one you should worship except Allah. That's the first message of the Quran. Second, أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَسُولُهُ That the Prophet is his messenger. So you see, Allah talks about the Prophet ﷺ, showing why you should follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Third, الثواب والعقاب. The one who takes Allah in worship and follows the way of the Prophet ﷺ, يَتَّبِعُونَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّينَ The ones who follow him, what their reward is, and the ones who disbelieve in him after knowing him, after understanding who he is, and after rejecting him, and then rejecting his Prophet ﷺ, what their punishment is. Those are the three structural messages of the Quran. Within that are seven themes. And those themes can be found, they are as-sab' al-mathani, they are described in Surah Al-Fatiha. Shaykh al-Islam ibn al-Qayyim, he says, the essence of Islam is the Quran. If you wanna, what is Islam? It's the Quran. And the entirety of the Quran is found in Surah Al-Fatiha. And the entirety of Surah Al-Fatiha is in the verse, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ Only you do we worship, only you do we seek help in. And that internal message, it has those seven themes in it. which is first the tawheed of Allah, that only Allah is worthy of worship. The Quran, it speaks of a day of resurrection and a day of questioning. It speaks about prophethood, not just of our prophet, but of prophets who came before him. It gives us the ahkam, the rulings and regulations of life. It speaks of reward and punishment, and it speaks about the rulings and regulations that relate to personal effects and law. Those seven themes of the Quran are intentional. In whatever surah you will find, you will have one of them alluded to. Now, this takes us... you all with me? Alhamdulillah. I do realize that for many of you, this is the first time that you get a taste of how the ulama kind of structure things as it relates to the Quran. And it's important that we set that as a mechanism to kind of humble our reading, because sometimes we pick up the Quran and we say, تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير, and we say, خلاص. I read the translation, brother. Yes, blessed is the, mashallah. La, the study of the Quran, it's something that is a wide ocean. And anything that you and I ever take from it is a drop, right? Drops from the Quran and from the study of it. The Quran is grouped into seven sections. And those sections, after the gathering of the entirety of the Quran, when you see how the Quran has been put into those sections, see, part of our belief as Muslims is that the Prophet ﷺ, before he passed away, the entirety of the Quran was dictated by him to scribes. It was scattered in different parchments. So there were more than 18 different Sahaba who would write down the Quran during his life, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. From them, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Muawiyah, ibn Abi Sufyan, many of them. And the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before his death, all of the Quran in its entirety was written down. But it was only collected during the time of Abi Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu wa arda. And the hadith, it's a long hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, many of the Sahaba came to Abu Bakr, and after the battle of Al-Yamama, many Huffaz were martyred. 70 who had memorized the Quran from the Prophet ﷺ had passed away. And they said, Ya Khalifata Rasulillah, we ask you to do something that wasn't done by the Prophet, to put it all in one volume, حتى لا يضيع كتاب الله, so that it is not scattered. Abu Bakr refused. He said, حتى شرح الله صدري, until Allah opened my chest to accept for me to do something not done by the Prophet ﷺ. So they said, who would do it? They said, choose someone who is intelligent, someone who is young, his memory is not faulty, someone لازم النبي, who lived closely with the Prophet ﷺ, someone who used to write the Quran at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and all eyes fell on Zayd ibn Thabit. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq came to him and said, Ya Zayd, إِنَّكَ رَجُلْ لَبِيبْ حَافِظْ لَا نَتَّهِمُكْ, you're a young man who's intelligent and has memorized the Quran. وَلَكَدْ كُنْتَ تَكْتِبُ الْوَحْيَ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِي حَيَاتِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. You used to write down the Quran in the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and no one has accused you of anything unjust or unrighteous. And Zayd said, لَوْ أَمَرُونِي أَنْ أَنْقِلَ جَبَلًا مِنَ الْجِبَالِ لَكَانَ أَهْوَنْ عَلَيْهِ. If they asked me to move a mountain from one place to another, it would be easier than to gather the Qur'an. But because I was ordered Abu Bakr and Umar, I had to, and it took him an effort of moving a mountain to put it all in one volume. And that was given to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and after his death, radiallahu anhu, it was given to Umar, and after the death of Umar, it went to Hafsa, radiallahu anha wa arda, his daughter, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and with Uthman radiallahu anhu, he took it from her and he made copies from that master set. The one who copied all seven copies was Zayd ibn Thabit. He was the same person who copied it again. And every time that the Quran would be brought together, he would corroborate every verse with at least two of the Huffaz of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in its placement and its rank. So the Qur'an that we have together, from its beginning to its end, from its alif to its ya, from alif, la, meem, until Surah An-Nas, everything intact in Al-Fatiha to the end is the book of Allah as was dictated by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now what you notice is when the Prophet would say, no, put these verses after these verses, this was done by Jibreel alayhi salam, would tell him, recite the Quran in this order. It's not recited chronologically. And therefore some people, when they come to study the Quran, well, which is the first surah? Which is the last surah? No, all of it came due to Nazal al-Quran Munajjama. It was revealed in different reasons, different places for different times. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who is one of the four people who the Prophet ﷺ said, خُذُ الْقُرْآنَ مِنْ أَرْبَعَ, as is narrated by Imam al-Bukhari, if you're going to study the Qur'an, take it from four people. And he began by naming Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, ibn Abd. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud mastered the reading of the Qur'an. He said, لَوْ أَنِّي أَعْلَمُ رَجُلًا, if I know of a man, أَعْلَمُ بِنِّي بِلَى الْقُرْآنَ تَبْلُغُهُ الْإِبْنِ, that camels can reach him, that I know that man knows more than me about the Qur'an, and my camel can take me to him, I would go. But I doubt there is anyone, for there isn't a verse that was revealed, فَلَمْ تَنْزِلْ آيَةً, except I witnessed its revelation, like I was there when the Prophet received it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or I was a part of its teaching, the Prophet first teaching it to people, or I knew why and for who it was revealed about. Like even if I wasn't in the room, I know why that verse, for what situation, for what purpose it was revealed. I know the Qur'an, radiallahu anhu wa arda. So they organized the Qur'an in that process according to the dictates and the teachings of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the seven groupings of the Qur'an, all of them will have one Makki and one Medina surah. And if you could just pay attention for a second. One Meccan surah at the very least and one Medina surah. And the Meccan surah, which talks about the roots, its comparative branches will be in the Medina surahs. So for example, the first section of the Qur'an, it's only one Meccan surah. What is it? Al-Fatiha. And then it has At-Tiwal, the longest surahs following it. The first group is Surah Al-Fatiha, it's the only one. And then after it, which is the small surah, it has the four longest surahs of the Qur'an, Al-Baqarah wa Ali Imran wa Nisa wa Al-Ma'idah. And those four, in comparison to Surah Al-Fatiha, it's the balance between them. And that shows you the importance of the Fatiha in our tradition. The message in the Fatiha is offset by the rulings and regulations of those four surahs. What you would receive in your knowledge of Allah in that surah, Al-Fatiha, the seven verses, all of the rulings and the regulations that come in those surahs that talk about Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Ali Imran, Surah Al-Nisa, Surah Al-Ma'idah is offset by that one surah. If you look down to the bottom, we're concerned today with the seventh and final category, which is the seventh section that the ulama have grouped of the Qur'an. And it begins with our surah of study, which we haven't begun yet. We'll begin shortly, inshallah. But it's important to introduce this study. Surah Al-Mulk, which is surah number 67 in the Qur'an. All of these two juz, the last two juz of the Qur'an, and that's why, you know, when your Qur'an teacher says, you have to memorize the last two juz of the Qur'an, why does he choose those two juz? It's not because the verses are shorter or smaller only, but because that's a group of the Qur'an, and that's how you study the Qur'an. Then you go and you memorize another section of the Qur'an. There are groupings, and the Prophet ﷺ, when you analyze how he would lead people in prayer, he would lead only from certain sections in certain prayers. So if he was going to lead Salatul Isha, he would read from the section of Al-Mufassal. You wouldn't find him reading from any place except from Surah Fussilat down to the end of the Qur'an. Those were the sections he would read. In Fajr, he would read from other places, from At-Tiwal. He would read from the long surahs, Yusuf and others. You would find that he would read from them. And that had a purpose behind it. There was a study for it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the last two juz of the Qur'an, the last 40 pages of the Qur'an, from Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk until the end of the Qur'an, only two of those surahs were revealed in Al-Madinah. And those two surahs are the last two surahs of the Qur'an. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. And it's as if, you know, these last two surahs, they're left there in at the end of the Qur'an, that when you've read the whole Qur'an and you come to the end, it's as if you are pleading to Allah. Oh Allah, you are the master of mankind. Malik al-Nas, the king of mankind. Ilahi al-Nas, you're the only one that mankind should worship. It's as if you're petitioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist you in life. Let's begin with the virtue of Surah Al-Mulk, and then we will continue, inshallah, thereafter with a short exegesis, an explanation and study of the surah. The manual that you have in front of you is not written by me, and it's important that intellectually, you know, as Muslims, alhamdulillah, we have a history of intellectual honesty. And some of the imams, Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, Ibn Sirin and others, they would say very early on, مِنْ بَرَكَةِ الْعِلْمِ أَنْ يُنْسَبَ الْعِلْمُ إِلَىٰ قَائِلِهِ. From the virtue of knowledge is that you establish who was the first one who said it. And therefore you always hear that when the Prophet is asked a question, he doesn't just answer. Allah tells him, say, قُلْ. I'm the one who's telling you, so let them know that it's not from you, that it's me who told you to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore you see in, you know, in verses in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, آمَنَ الرَّسُولُ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ كُلٌّ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ. Why in that structure? Because Allah sent an angel with a book to a messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there is a barakah in the delivery of the Qur'an that is being given. Why is Surah Al-Mulk so important? It is Al-Munjiyah. It is the savior. It is the protector. The ulama, they call it Al-Waqiyah, the one that shields you. You know the word taqwa? It comes from that same root as, you know, a protection, a hiding. You will protect yourself with it. In where and in what? In every condition in life. Many of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, they speak about the afterlife. But you only receive the good of something in the afterlife if it proceeded with good in the current life. And therefore many of the imams, when they analyze these hadith, which we will look at a few of them quickly inshallah, if you turn the page, now this booklet you have in front of you is from a website. It's called versebyverse.com. And I recommend it to you inshallah. Not everything in it is perfect, as with any website. But it's a good place to study the verses of the Qur'an. Anytime you want a summary, 10, 15 pages, that tells you in English, what's this surah about? What are its meanings? What are some of the things that are important? You can refer to it inshallah. Now because this manual is in front of you, I'm not going to be reading it through with you. So I have my own notes that we're going to be adding, as I've introduced already. It's not a part of the notes that you had in front of you there, inshallah. But turn to the second page where it says the virtues of Surah Al-Mulk. Many of the hadith are listed there for you. All of them, inshallah, are hasan or sahih. And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ سُورَةً فِي الْقُرْآنِ. There's a chapter in the Qur'an. ثَلَاثِينَ آيَةً. It's as if the Prophet saying, look how small it is. It's only 30 verses. It's not something you have to read a long time. It's only 30 verses. The Sahaba at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they used to count distance by verses. So if you say to someone, hey, how far is it? He would say, 60 verses. You know, you talk about how many minutes. For them it was ayah. يعني كم تبعد؟ يعني 60 ayah. Where did Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas live in comparison to the house of the Prophet? 40 ayah, 40 verses. And if you walk it from there to there, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, may Allah bless you with a visit to the Medina of the Prophet ﷺ. His house was very close to the Prophet ﷺ. They would say, كان يقرأ الإخلاص. All he knew was قلوا الله أحد. He was, يعني, that's how close he was. قلوا الله أحد, he's there. MashaAllah. But it shows you the frame of reference and how people used to think about the beauty of the Quran. So it's a the Prophet saying it's a surah. It's so small. It's really, really easy to read. It's not something that will burden you. It's only 30 verses, but look what it can do. This is the wording. This is what the Prophet is trying to instigate, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. شفعت, it made shafa'a. And Allah tells us in the Quran that the shafa'a only comes to the one He permits. Illa an yasha Allah. Allah said you're allowed to make shafa'a, even the Prophet ﷺ. You know, some people, I had some of my students, they said, Sheikh, you memorize the Quran, you're allowed 7 people. I said, yes. He goes, can I be on the list? I said, no. It's not my choice. But even if it was my choice, no. I have my wife and kids, my father, my mom. Who are you, Yahi? You gotta go memorize your own Quran. He goes, okay. No, take, you know, there's precedent, right? But لا يشفعون إلا أن يشاء الله. Allah gives you that ability to make shafa'a. Even the Prophet ﷺ, he's not permitted ﷺ to make shafa'a except until instructed by Allah. So Allah says, this person, ask me for him, Ya Muhammad ﷺ. Because this is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only He knows what has happened when the Prophet was not there. And the Prophet ﷺ says, what's the evidence for this, that the Prophet doesn't just choose ﷺ? The Prophet ﷺ says in the authentic hadith, which is narrated by Imam Muslim, Imam Ahmad, the Prophet ﷺ says, on the day of judgment, I will see people from my ummah. And there's a riwayah similar to it in Bukhari. فَيُدْفَعُونَ عَنِّي. But they will be pushed away from me. فَأَقُولُ لِلْمَلَائِكِ. The angels who are pushing them away. إِنَّهُم مِّنْ أُمَّتِي. They're my people. I can see the mark of wudu, they prayed, I know them, they are my ummah. But the angels will respond to me, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُوا مِنْ بَعْدِكَ. Ya Muhammad, you don't know what they did after you left them. How they changed and perverted and added heresy to your deen. They're still from your ummah, but they're not worthy of being near you in this way. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that proves that the Prophet doesn't know what has happened after his ummah, after his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He doesn't know what that man did, what that woman did. He knows us through our salawat upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore when he sees us, he says, but this is a person who loved me. This is a person who knows me. But the angels will say, yes, but they did this. And because of that, Allah yahjibhum annak. Allah's pushing them away from you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, until Allah allows them to come near you, until Allah allows you to make shafa'a for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the shafa'a of our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this surah is given shafa'a, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the authentic hadith in Sahih Muslim, الصيام والقرآن يشفعان للعبد. Siyam and Qur'an both make shafa'a for a person. Your fasting will say, مَنَعْتُهُ الطَّعَامَ وَالشَّرَابَ وَالشَّهْوَةَ بِالنَّارِ. I kept him away from food and eating and drinking all day. And your Quran will say, مَنَعْتُهُ النَّوْمَ بِاللَّيْلِ. Oh Allah, I kept him awake at night. فَشَفِعْنِ فِي. Allow me to make shafa'a for him. فَيَشْفَعَان. So they will ask Allah, can we make shafa'a? And Allah will say, yes. فَيَشْفَعَان. Then they will allow. So Surah Al-Mulk is one of those surahs. شَافِعَتْ لِصَاحِبِهَا حَتَّى غُفِرَ لَهُ. It kept asking Allah, asking Allah, asking Allah, asking Allah to forgive him, until Allah forgave all of his sins. And that surah is تبارك الذي بيده الملك. That surah is تبارك, the 67th chapter of the Quran. In another beautiful hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, سُورَةً فِي الْقُرْآنِ. There's a chapter in the Quran, خَاصَمَتْ. It debated, argued, stood in front and pushed a case for عن صاحبها, for the one who used to love it, read it, who it considered its companion. Look at the word صاحبها, its companion. Meaning it's someone who was, it was always a part of their life. Every night in their life, it consumed them and they recited it. حتى أدخلته الجنة. Not just forgave his sins, but now here we have another riwayah that says until it would not leave him until he entered Jannah. So in every step of your life, in your day, in your night, in your death, in your qabr, in your grave, after your grave, in your resurrection, in your punishment, may Allah protect us. Every step it was there, khasama, fighting on your behalf. Let him out. Bring him forward. Oh Allah, forgive him. Until it leaves you only when you have entered Jannah. And it is tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. In another authentic riwayah, it is deemed hasan by Imam al-Tirmidhi. The Prophet ﷺ said that this is a surah, 30 verses, that the one who recites it every night, they will be protected from the punishment of the grave. In the riwayah of Umm Salama, she says, I cannot remember a night, بَاتَ عَنْدِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, where the Prophet had time in my home at night, إِلَّا وَقَرَأَ تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ, except I heard him read, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ, from its beginning to its end, صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. We're going to take a pause, inshallah, from our discussion, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our time a time of reward and sadaqah upon ourselves and families. Allahumma ameen. We continue now. You know, we spoke a little bit about the virtues of Surah Al-Mulk, and some of them will become self-evident as we continue. I don't want to just chronicle, you know, five or six different hadith, but I want to put it in the context of why the Prophet ﷺ speaks about the surah as being powerful for the grave, why it's powerful on the Day of Judgment, why it intercedes for our forgiveness, and why it intercedes and won't leave us until bi-idhnillah we enter Jannah, and why it must be a nightly thing. Why is it every day that it should be a part of your reading? So to begin, let's look at the essential theme of the surah. And to establish that, I just a very small blurb there. The general theme of Surah Al-Mulk, and Surah Al-Mulk, you can translate that word, you know, mulk, to dominance or control. And it's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us that you are not in control. I'm in control. Look around you and feel what insignificance you are to the scheme of everything that is above you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about sab'a samawatin tibaqa, seven heavens, you know, seven layered places of creation. Look around and see you. And at that time, the people of Quraysh were a very arrogant, proud people. They were a people who, in nasab, to them, lineage was very important. Who your father was, who your mother was, what tribe you belonged to, that was everything. And Allah, in many places in the Quran, it's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to them, don't you know where you're from? And don't you know how insignificant you are in comparison to the nations before you and to the nations that will come after you? And before we begin, I want you just to ask, you know, to answer a few questions. Who lived a more luxurious life? You or Pharaoh? Really? Like the contour orthopedic mattress you sleep on every night. Did Pharaoh have something better than that? Did he have medical care? You know, mashallah, we have a few dentists in the audience today. I'm normally at times scared of dentists, but they're good brothers, mashallah. Jazakumullah khair. Did he have better dental care or you? Did he dress in better tailor? You know, I know he had a lot of gold. There's a lot of gold. But did he have the refinements? Could he turn on an air conditioned system? Could he just click? Ah, 23 degrees. When he pushed, you know, a button, would the water heater click in and he could take a bath with? Did he have the scents that we have today? Did he have the variety of foods, the refrigeration systems that you and I had? Did he have the military power that is found in one pistol? You know, could you imagine if you walked in front of Pharaoh and he just said, bang, to one of his guards. Whoa! Who has, and see, the frame of reference, of course, and that's what, you know, the Quran is about, coherence. When you look at those in the past, and you see how arrogant they were, yani, he's walking the earth as if there's no, but you're going to die. And Allah's saying to Fir'aun, you're telling people that you're God, but you know inside yourself, you're nothing. You know you're not anything. Ya Aba Jahl, you know you're not anything. Yes, you own this man. You can, Umayyah, you own Bilal ibn Rabah. But what does that do for you? What is there for you other than that dominance? Hold on a second. I'm the most dominant. بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ. I'm the one who all dominance is with him. And therefore, the surah theme is that it begins to allow you and I to understand the mysteries of the universe, and that our earthbound knowledge, what we can see and what we sense today, what they could see and sense in their time, leads us to understand that we must be in utter dependence upon the one who put everything in its place. And therefore, you know, in this surah, you're going to hear verses where Allah says, أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقُ. Does not the Creator know what's best for the creation? Because hold on a second, you don't know better than me. I'm telling you, look around you, come to understand who I am, what my significance is in your life. Jazakallah khair. So let's begin the surah insha'Allah. Always whenever we begin a study of the Qur'an, and we always begin with al-isti'adha, which is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the shaitan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِمَّا يَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغٌ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. As a general principle, anytime you feel disturbed and you feel that the shaitan has upset you or sorrow or whatever it is, seek protection with Allah. مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. From the accursed shaitan, the one who you would stone. You know, rajim, marjum. Rajm, inshaAllah, when we go to Hajj, you pick up a stone and you throw it at him. That's what Ibrahim did. When the devil manifested, he picked up a stone, kept him away from him, threw it at him. This is rajim. And this same statement will come in the surah, that Allah uses this as an effect for the shayateen. Allah also says, not now just in general, but in particular in the Quran, قرأت القرآن فاستعذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. When you come to recite the Quran, begin it by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from the shaitan. The question begs itself, why does the shaitan come when I'm reading the Quran? Yani, I thought the shaitan, he likes bad things. No, the thing that attracts the shaitan most is you doing good things. And therefore Allah says that the shaitan's declaration of war is لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صَرَاتَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. I'm going to sit on the straight path, not on the crooked path. So anytime you say Allahu Akbar for salah, what do you say first? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, after istiftah. Why? Because the moment you say Allahu Akbar, he comes. Not just to you, but even to the best of us, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did battle with Ifrit. He says, as narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he moved back in his salah. Like he saw a visual manifestation of a shaitan trying to disturb his salah. And the Prophet said, I held him. And the Sahaba said they saw his right hand extend and he grabbed something until it stayed still. And the Prophet said, had it not been for the dua of Sulaiman, I would have killed it and put it for the children to practice their arrows at it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sulaiman's dua was that I get a mulk, لا ينبغي لأحد من بعدي. That I have this power over this shayateen, that no one has it after me. It's not that the Prophet didn't have the power, but the Prophet respected his brother, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because as a part of our understanding of the nubu'ah of a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every miracle given to the Prophets preceding him was given to him as a power sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without request. But because of his humility sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would not use what he did not need. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We then begin, because it is the beginning of a surah, we say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And as a point, as a side note, the ulama, they tell us it is not a necessity. Many of the ulama, they say that the basmala, it's only necessary in two places in the Quran. And that is because it is the beginning of the Fatiha, it is a surah of a Sab' al-Mathani. So you say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the qira'ah of some of the qura'ah, they make it a part of the Qur'an, and that seems to be the weaker opinion. And that's why you see when you open your Qur'an, it'll say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, but not in the same script as the Qur'an. It'll put it above it, right? It'll put it in a different place, so you don't get confused. Except Al-Fatiha, and the second surah is Surah An-Naml. Innahu min Sulaiman, when Saba', when the people of Bilqis received the verses, received a letter from Sulaiman, she read it out to them and she said, Innahu min Sulaiman, wa innahu bismillahir rahmanir rahim. And therefore, it was a constant tradition of the Prophets of Allah to begin with al-basmala, whether it was bismika Allahum or bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The majority of opinion, of course, is that it is praiseworthy, it is mustahab or mandub to recite the basmala, but it is not considered an ayah from the Quran except in those two places, right? So you can begin your recitation without saying it, although it is better to say it. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i's opinion is different. He holds anytime you begin the recitation of the Quran, even from the middle of a surah, beginning of a surah, doesn't matter where, in salah, outside salah, tajhar bil basmala. And therefore, the Shafi'i imams, when they read salah, they'll say, Allahu Akbar, they do their dua, and then they yajhar, they say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and they might say it also in the beginning of each and every recitation of the Quran. Allah says, and when I say Allah says, it is only the Arabi. It is only Quran and Arabiyan غير ذي عوج. The Quran is an Arabic Quran. Lisan and Arabi. It is with a language that is only in Arabi. So anything that you see of transliteration, translation, anything that seeks to resemble it other than the Arabic script and the Arabic sound is not the Quran, is not the word of Allah. It is the understanding of a man or a person at a time of what they think Allah said. It is not the word of Allah. So when you read the translation, blessed is he whose hand is dominion. No, this isn't the word of Allah. When you say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk, that is the word of Allah. Even if it is a grouping of letters that don't make up a word. Alif, Lam, Mim. It's not even a word. But Alif, Lam, Mim is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the recitation is scheduled, is taught to us by Allah. What do I mean its recitation is scheduled? Is the sound of the letters is not our choice. In Arabic, every letter has a name, a sound to it. So, alifun, ba'un, ta'un, lamun, mimun. But when you come, you know, if you were to give an Arabic Christian, you say, alif, lamun, you say, alifun, lamun, alam. You know, it's not a word that means something. Why don't we say alifun lamun mimun? Why do we say alif lam mim? Who said it that way? Who did we hear? We as an ummah here say it that way? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And therefore the Quran is tawqif in its utterance. It is stopped. You can't just invent your own grammar rules. You can't just make your own, oh, I like this tune. Have you seen that YouTube video where they sing the Quran with an orchestra? Al-iyadu billah. They have this, there's an orchestra and a guy with a violin and they're doing ayat al-kursi. Nah. Why? Because alif, the sound of it is not my choice or your choice. It's spoken by who? Was heard by who? The Sahaba. From who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the Prophet ﷺ received the Qur'an in seven sounds. Seven utterances. So if I read Surah Al-Fatiha, I can read it just in Al-Fatiha. غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهُمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمُ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. All of them were written, were spoken by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and each of them was due to the pronunciation of the various groups that lived around at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فاحنا عندنا مصريين بيقول لك جيم ومش جيم. You have Egyptians who say جيم. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took intricacies in the language spoken by the people who surrounded him. And the Qur'an came to reflect that understanding from them. So some of them, the way the word would be pronounced, Allah reveals it in a way that they would understand it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received the Qur'an ala sab'ati ahruf. There's a famous hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. Umar al-Khattab, you know he's a tough guy. MashaAllah, radiyallahu anhu arda. He came to pray, and the person who's leading the salah, salat al-fajr, qara al-furqan, recited Surah Al-Furqan in a way that Rasulullah ﷺ didn't teach me. فَتَمَلَّكْتُ نَفْسِي حَتَّى أَنْهَى. He said, I had to control myself until the end of the prayer. I almost took him in the middle of the prayer. How dare you read it in this way? So I held myself. As-salamu alaykum as-salam. He finished. فَرَفَعْتَهُ إِلَى رَسُولَ. I picked him up and took him to the Prophet ﷺ. قُلْتُ لَهُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ يَقْرَأُ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. In a letter, in a sound, different to the one you taught me. Prophet said, let him go, Ya Umar. اقرأ علي. Umar, read to me, حتى أنهيت, until I finished the same passage. وقال له اقرأ فقرأ علي. It was Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Read, Mu'adh, right? He said, كذلك أنزل وكذلك أنزل. In this way it was read, was sent to me, in this way it was sent to me. Both of them, right? They have a different dialect, different sound, right? And the meaning is always intact in the verses that are revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course, there's a lot of complexity and intricacy. None of the tafsir that you read today, like Tafsir Ibn Kathir, was written with qira'at Hafs an Asim. The qira'ah you and I mostly read is Hafs an Asim. Most of the tafsir wasn't for that qira'ah. It was for the qira'ah of Nafi'ah. والكسائي. الإمام الشافعي, the reason he used to say بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم is because he used to follow the riwayah of Al-Kisa'i. That's why he would read بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, because he considered it a part of every surah, right? So it has those intricacies in its meanings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and therefore when I say that from now on until the end, it is for the Arabi, and I say Allah means, or what could be translated to, are the translations or the agasis that we seek to do. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور الذي خلق سبع سماوات طباقا ما ترى في خلق الرحمن من تفاوت فارجع البصر هل ترى من فطور ثم ارجع البصر كرتين ينقلب إليك البصر خاسئا وهو حسير ولقد زينا السماء الدنيا بمصابيح وجعلناها رجوما للشياطين وأعتدنا لهم عذاب السعير. It's a powerful statement from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to begin this surah. And there are few surahs, this one and Al-Furqan, that begin with Tabarak. And the word Tabarak is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extends for himself his blessedness. And Allah affirms it for himself without you needing to do it. See, most people, when they want to feel good about themselves, they want to hear it from others. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you worship him or if you don't worship him, he is already without need of your worship. If you worship him, it does not increase him. If you did not worship him, it does not diminish him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you give it to someone other than him, he's not jealous, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is not upset that people worship other than him because he wants their worship. It's out of a need. Give me the attention. La. Without anything, Allah is Malik al-Mulk. And therefore, on the Day of Judgment, the Prophet ﷺ said, when everything ceases, Allah will say, and he will answer. He will ask himself, لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ. To who is the kingdom today? To who is all of this today? لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. And only Allah will answer after the time that He permits. Only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dominant over all things. عَزَّ وَجَلْ. The word baraka, which is part of this tabarak, baraka, it means increase, plentifulness, excess. And it means three particular things as it relates to us. That what is confined can be made great. And what is missing can arrive from where you don't expect. And what you fear its loss can be protected. Those three things. What is small, Allah makes it more useful than what is big. And what is not with you, Allah brings it when you thought, I could never have it. How, where am I going to get this? Where would this come? And Allah sends it. And what you have and you're afraid, oh, I don't want to lose this, I don't want this to disappear, Allah guarantees it for you so that it does not dissipate from your life. And therefore the source of all barakah is only Allah. And therefore, there's this false understanding amongst the illiterate amongst us as Muslims, who assume that something or someone can have barakah in it just because of itself. You will see this, I put up this video on my Facebook page of some of our, may Allah forgive them, some of the brothers, they bring knives, scissors, nails, things to cut thread from the Kaaba. There they are making tawaf, and they, Allah, you see this lady, this man, ripping at the cloth of the Kaaba. One of the people, they said, why do they always raise it up? I said, it's to show you that it's stone. It's stone. Yani, it's rock. Where'd the rock come from? That mountain over there. It's nothing special. They didn't bring special rock. There's only one rock that's special, that the Prophet ﷺ told us is special. The only reason we acknowledge that rock is because the Prophet acknowledged it, ﷺ, and we only acknowledge it in the way he acknowledged it. The Prophet ﷺ didn't come to the black stone, take his hat off, wipe it, and say, my hat, it has the black stone on it. No. You made a mistake, you should have touched it with your fingers. That's what the Prophet ﷺ did. And if you couldn't, your hat touched it, then your hat, you kiss your hat, that's it. The Prophet ﷺ teaches us that. It's not that all of a sudden something transfers to other things, you become holy in that way. La. It's a rock, it's just building. The house of Allah, it is a place that's a marker. When you pray from here to there, you don't focus on it in your brain. You're not standing there and imagining the Kaaba. Oh, mashallah. La. Your thought is what you are reciting. And that's Tawheed. That's why Umar ibn al-Khattab, every time he did Hajj, he would stand in front of the black stone. And the hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. Sahih Muslim, excuse me. He would stand in front of the black stone, and he would raise his voice as loud as he can, and he would say, Allahumma inni a'lamu annaka hajar. Oh, by Allah, I know you are nothing but a stone. And if I had not seen the Prophet ﷺ kiss you, I would not kiss you, because you're a stone. But because he did it, he knows better, so I will follow him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never kissed anywhere else. He never did anything else, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So the source of barakah is Allah, and Allah puts barakah in what he seeks, and it's transient. No one has barakah just, you know, all the time, except the prophets of Allah. Even after their life, their remnants, and this is from the athar, contains barakah. Umm Salama, as is in Sahih al-Bukhari, she had some of the hair, either of the beard or the head of the Prophet ﷺ, and she was the one who shaved the head of the Prophet ﷺ on the day of Hudaybiyah. And it was ordered that it be distributed to the 1,500 Sahaba. Some of the hair, you know, one Sahabi, the hair of the Prophet ﷺ touched him when his hair turned gray, all of it except the places, the hair of the Prophet ﷺ that touched. This is the barakah of the Prophet ﷺ. All of his hair turned gray except the place where the Prophet's hair had touched him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? This is from the barakah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umm Salama, she had some hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When someone got sick and they couldn't cure them with medicine, she would dip the hair of the Prophet in a cup of zamzam. They would drink it, they would get better. This is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he is a conduit of the barakah sent to him by Allah azza wa jal. Those are all sahih athar in Sahih al-Bukhari. تبارك الذي بيده الملك, in whose hand Allah alone is all kingdom, is all control, is all dominance. And therefore from the very first moment, Allah is setting for you and I in this surah that no one has power, no one has authority, no one has control, even in the things that they think they do, except Allah. وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ, and it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is able to do all things. So the first lesson that we take, you can shift inshallah, we're going to take 50 some odd lessons from this surah inshallah today. The first lesson that we take is that you're limited in your creation by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You and I as human beings were never meant to be from those who had utter power over ourselves or others. And if you are given wealth, you might lose health. And if you have health and children, you might lose wealth. If you're given prosperity and safety and wealth, you might be depleted in happiness and contentment. You might have a jealous heart. You have everything around you, but you keep looking to others who are beneath you. Why do they have this and that? And therefore, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنَّ الْكَمَالَ لِلَّهِ وَحْدَهُ. No one is complete except Him. Everyone is limited but him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, the power of Allah is beyond limit. وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And he is over everything, and this word shay means anything. But the one who made things is who? Who's the one who made everything? So before they have become a thing, who is the one already in control? Because he's the one who made it. إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا إِذَا أَرَادَ أَمْرًا فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Be and it becomes. And it's only after the instruction of it to be that it becomes shay'. And therefore when you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to you and I in the Qur'an, Allah forgives all sins. يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبِ جَمِيعًا. Your sins are a shay'. Your sins are a thing that you have brought into this life by the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore part of your hope is in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he uses his qudra, which is his rahmah. The imams, they used to be those who would make this dua. Some have said it's not a dua that should be made. Others say it's a dua that is made, if you understand it correctly, it's useful. Some would say, oh Allah, don't punish me. Don't hold me accountable to my sins with your justice. Because if Allah is going to be just with us, all of us are in trouble. But deal with me with your ihsan, with your mercy. And the other ulama, they said, no, Allah's justice is his ihsan. It's his qudra, his ability is over everything. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is beyond limit because all limits were created by him. And he is limitless, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the things he has created is you. So you are a part of Allah's authority and power. We take as another lesson that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he is not blessed from what he provides us, and our blessings is not because we repay him for what he's given. You know, sometimes you expect people, if you do good to them, you give something back. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives and gives and gives, not because, okay, give me back in return. La. His blessedness extends beyond that, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is without need. In the next ayah, Allah says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتِ وَالْحَيَاةِ. And this is something that many of the commentators, they spoke on. Why did Allah speak about his creation of death before life? When naturally you live, then you die. Actually, it's a way of Allah, it's a proverbial way of Allah saying to you, when you live your life, look to your death. Because then you will see your true life. Allah saying to you and I, know that I'm powerful in everything. And know that I've created you to die. So don't get attached to anything in this life too much. Because the first step in your life is in life. The first step of your life is actually death. That's your first place that you're going to meet me. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتِ وَالْحَيَاةِ. Now Allah says that he created death. Meaning death and non-existence are not the same thing. You know, some people say, well, before I was born, I was nothing, so that was death. La. By Allah saying he created death, it means that Allah, there was non-death, there was non-existence, but there was a creation of death. And that means that your death is created, its time is known to Allah. He created for you the hour you will return to him. Just like he created you the hour you were brought here, he created you the hour and the condition and the time that you would return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتِ وَالْحَيَاةِ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. That he has placed us here to test us. Balwa is a trial, a difficulty, a hardship. And therefore the nature of life has always been toil. If you descend, Ya Adam, Allah says to Adam in the Qur'an, فَتَشْقَى, you will be in hardship. Because you're on earth, you must be tested to meet the requirements of being given access to al-hayawan, the true life, the true existence in the next life. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Which of you is best in deeds? Now many people misunderstand this. When you read it in English, it says, which of you is best indeed? It's as if you're competing with other people. Who are you competing with? Yourself. Not just yourself as you are now, but you're competing with yourself, your better self and your worse self. Inside me, there's a better Yahya Ibrahim. There's a person who prays better, who's a better husband, better father, better teacher. There's a person who is better in their salah. And the competition is within myself to bring and to reach that level. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ From amongst you, who of you will improve themselves to be the best of who they can be? And that was always the central message of the prophets of Allah. They always wanted, you know, whenever you see the Prophet ﷺ transitioning someone from sin to good deeds, he always improved them in a way that kept them the same as who they are. The Prophet ﷺ says, the best of you in Jahiliyyah are the best of you in Islam. If you were the best trader in your kufr days, in your non-practicing days, Uthman ibn Affan was a very good tradesman. He was a very good trader, very good businessman before Islam. What did he become after Islam? Did he change his job? He became the best in his trading as a Muslim. And that's a very important concept. The Prophet ﷺ never came to change anyone. He came to perfect. And here you hear the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ In Sahih Muslim, the Prophet says, I've been sent to perfect the mannerisms of people, the etiquettes they have, not to change. So when the Prophet came to the people of Quraysh, he didn't say, wipe all this out, let's start new. He said, no, this thing, drunkenness, let's take it away. This thing, riba, let's remove it. This thing, this thing about how you treat your women, your wives, your slave, remove these are the imperfections you have in your society, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ Allah ends this ayah by saying, so the first one, Allah refers to himself, عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ Power, capable, control, dominance. In this one, Allah says, he is Aziz. And he is Ghafoor. And the words for Aziz is mighty and forgiving. Mighty is Allah saying, I am mighty enough to punish you. If I want to punish you, you can't escape. But I am forgiving to whoever I want, even those who might mistake that they have gone too far, they have hope with me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore the maghfirah of Allah is a central theme in this surah. You will hear him refer to himself as al-ghafoor, and that we should seek his maghfirah often in this surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also shows that there is a purpose for his creation. So he tells us to look around us. الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ It is He alone who created seven heavens, tibaqa, layering them one atop of another. And you know, in the Arabic language, in Egyptian even, you would say tabaq, you know, it's a plate, one on top of another, because it's stackable. Now, the word sama in Arabic means anything above you. That's the general meaning. So when Allah is saying samawat, it doesn't necessarily mean definable only seven. And it is from ada' al-balagha to say sab'a samawat, that there's more than what you can appreciate. In Arabic, the word and the number 7, 70, 700, they all kind of mean the same thing. It's so much you can't count. When you say to someone, yani it would take 700 years, to them, living in the desert, they're illiterate people, don't know, 700, how do you count up to 700? Right? You say, Yabni, Ba'id, Sabah, 7 months to go. Oh, 7 months, wow. It's a far off place. Sab'a samawat, it's creation that's unimaginable. Tibaqa, and it's not just one, it's one on top of another. So there's seven on seven on seven, and it's you can't even envision it. This is the meaning, سَبْعَ سَمَوَاتِ It's not لِلْتَحْدِيدِ وَالْحَصْرِ The Imam al-Baydawi and others, they say, it's not to confine it to a limitation of seven specific only. Some of the scholars of tafsir, they began to say, well listen, even if we try to look, let's see what seven are being referred to. So there's, you know, some of the contemporary ones, they look into science and they say, you know, there's ionosphere and troposphere and, you know, in the atmosphere, it looks like there's seven, maybe that's what it means. La. Allahu A'lam, right? And things that are meant to be nakira, left unopened, left by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this way, should not be confined illa bidaleel. You should not confine it, except if you have evidence from the Prophet ﷺ confining it to something. So where does the Prophet confine it? He says in his migration, in his ascension, excuse me, in al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, he talks about the heavens. And he talks about the Jannah, that there were seven heavens that he ascended to, the first one, second one, third one. But he does not say that in between them there is nothing. And therefore you see this from other hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, between every sama, another, from every one layer to another layer, there are many layers. In one hadith that you and I are familiar with, that when you recite the Quran, on the day of judgment, Allah will say to you, for every ayah you know, rise a layer in Jannah. Right? So in between the seven layers in Jannah, the seven layers in heaven in that sense, there are seven, there are multiple layers. Same with the seven heavens of creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not meant to be definable in that confined amount. مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَانِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتٍ فارجع البصر هل ترى من فطور ثم ارجع البصر كرتين ينقلب إليك البصر خاسئا وهو حسير. Allah now defies mankind and he says, Lahi, listen, go out and try to find any flaw in the creation of all that is around you. When you look up into the sky, see if you can find a tear or a flaw or an inconsistency or a moment of chaos. See if you could see that there aren't patterns, because at that time, the Arab were very well and famous in their divining skills. They would look up to the stars and they would say, it would rain, this one will have a child, this one won't be given a child. If you get married in this week, it's a good week. They used to try to look up in the stars. And that's why in the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحَ. We have put lamps, meaning sources of guidance in the heavens. وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. And we've made it something that the devils will be cast away with. And it's as if Allah is saying that those who are relying on these things, it actually makes their conjecture and their false fortune telling something that will destroy them by it. A more literal translation and a more literal definition you can take from Al-Imam Ibn Kathir and others, where they say that the devils on the day of judgment, they will be confined and be missiled by places from the heavens that are above us, and that they will be marjoom with those celestial stars. وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحَ وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. In this, Al-Imam Al-Baydawi and Al-Baghawi and others, they say that there are two kinds of devils. The shayateen that are being cursed by Allah in this, the first of them are the human shaitan. The ones who look up into the stars and deceive people. The ones who say, I know something others don't. The ones who try to lead people astray away from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that those kind of people who lead people away from Allah are as corrupt and as bad as those who are the devils that whisper within. And both of them are worthy and equal of being categorized as dangerous to our faith in Allah. The material shaitan can be that person who gives you a phone call and says, hey, what are you doing tonight? Where are you? What? Oh, did you hear what they said about this one? They act in a way that breaks the limit of right and wrong. What does the word shaitan mean? Someone who recognizes a limitation and crosses over it willingly. Shat. He goes further than what is expected. And therefore there are shayateen al-ins wal-jinn. There are shaitan from those who are human and those who are immaterial and unseen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he concludes by giving us important advice. To not just look up once or twice or three times. Allah's saying, look and look again. And it's as if Allah, it's an ada, it's as if Allah is saying, keep looking until you become certain of me. Because the more you look up and the more you look around, the more you see things in the creation that I have set the more that you will recognize that I am who I say I am, and I am who the Prophet is telling you I am, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Finally, speaking of the unseen without knowledge is a hindrance to the growing of faith. And therefore it's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to people who want to believe in what others say to them and want to hear, you know, this person, oh, look, you know, the horoscope said, or this was being written, or this person told me, oh, I saw a dream and this is what I think will happen to you. That those who go off on those tangents, that this is something that hinders faith from growing. So push it out of your life, keep it away from your life, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from it.